Fine, so next force is spring force. Write down spring. Now, there can be many kinds of spring, alright? The most common form of the spring is, looks like this. This is a spring, right? The spring will have its natural length, okay? Let's say the length of the spring, which is L naught, is its natural length, okay? The behavior of the spring is such that it tries to regain its original length. Fine? It will make an effort to regain its original length. Fine? So if I change its length, it will try to come back to its original length. That is what it means. Alright? So if I compress it like this, what will it try to do? It will try to expand. So it will push both sides with some force. Okay? And if I stretch it, it tries to contract. Fine? And if it is at its natural length, if it is at its natural length, it will not apply any force or effort. Fine? This is what it means. Okay? So if you keep spring on your hand like this, a small spring, it will not apply any force. But if I compress it, it will try to expand. If you expand, it will try to compress. Okay? So whatever is connected at the two ends will also feel the force, yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. So suppose it is like this. If I pull the block like this, spring will try to pull it like that. Okay. And if I compress the block, it try to push. Fine. Fine, so if a mass is compressed, then it will get a force this way because it is connected to the spring and spring is trying to regain its original length. Fine, so this is the property of the spring and the spring can apply push or pull, both. It can be both push or pull depending on whether it is stretched or compressed. Okay. Now the force of the spring, write down the force of the spring acts along the spring. Okay, it acts along the spring. And the magnitude of the force of the spring is proportional to what? What do you think it is proportional to?
Length of the
delta.
Change, yeah. Change in the length of the spring, delta x. Okay, or if you represent delta x by just x, you can say it is proportional to x, where x represents the change in the length. Change of the length of the spring. And the force also should depend on the material and various other things, how it is packed and everything else. Okay, so these are two things force depends on. So if you combine these two, you will get an equation like this. F is equal to K times X. Fine. This is the magnitude of the force. K is called the spring constant. This is the spring constant. Okay, so if K is high, it means it is a stiff spring, a very strong spring. And this is about the spring force. Any doubts? So these are the five forces that I have introduced to you. Okay, so now we can apply these knowledge in solving few questions. When I say solving few questions, today's session is restricted on drawing the free body diagram. So let's I'll quickly introduce to you what is a free body diagram, then we'll start solving the questions. Okay? Write down free body diagram. Free body diagram is also referred as FBD. Okay? FBD. Now when object is accelerating, for example, a mass is moving with acceleration of 2 meter per second square, that acceleration is because of the force only, right? Does it depend on who is creating that force? How it is getting created? No, it only depends on the force. Okay, so ultimately it is about force and what is the acceleration. So free body diagram is just a representation of all the forces acting on the block. Okay, we are taking one body at a time, one mass at a time, and drawing all the forces acting on it. That's it. This is the free body diagram. Okay, we are taking one body at a time and showing all the forces on it. How are we showing it? With an arrow. The head represents direction of the force. Getting it? Tail should touch the mass. Okay, write down. When you draw the free body diagram, tail will touch the mass and the head will show the direction of the force. For example, you have this situation. Okay, mass is kept over here. You take the mass in air like this and just show all the forces acting on it. Like this. This can be friction, this is normal reaction, this is mg. Okay, so this is the free body diagram of this mass. This mass. Getting it? This is what I mean by free body diagram. Alright, so we'll be drawing free body diagram of various cases. Fine. And once you draw free body diagram, then you can apply Newton's second law of equation, force equal to mass m equation. Okay, let's see how. So what do you think the first step in drawing free body diagram is? First step. Find out which object you are drawing free body diagram. Okay, shortlist or identify the object for which you are drawing free body diagram. That is step number one. If you don't know which object you are drawing free body diagram, there is nothing like drawing free body diagram, right? So step number one, find out one object on which you will be drawing the forces. Okay, that is step number one. Step number two, step two is, write it down. Step two is, take that object only and redraw it. Redraw that object without changing its orientation. If object is kept like this, you know, it is kept at a slant like that, you should not rotate and make it straight. It should be like that only. Okay? Redraw that object only that object, nothing else. Okay, suppose object is kept on the inclined plane, do not draw the inclined plane, only draw that mass without changing its orientation. Okay, that is step number two. Step number three is draw your x and y axis. Choose x and y axis. Fine. The chosen x and y axis, that is step number 3. See, what I am telling you is not something to memorize, but I am trying to structure your thought in the right direction. Once you solve, let's say 10-15 questions, you don't need to think about these steps, they will automatically come. But if you don't write these step by step manner and think in this direction, you will still get there, but right now you may get there by solving 10 questions. If you don't think in a systematic manner, you may get there after solving 50 to 100 questions. That's all. Okay, that's the only difference. So that is step number 3. What is that? Choose x and y axis. So you can choose x y axis smartly. How should you choose x and y axis? So that most of the vectors are already along x and y axis. You have to take least number of components. Getting it? Otherwise, you have to take component of forces along x and y axis, yes or no? Right? Step number 4, draw all the forces as it is. draw all the forces as it is and draw all the forces as it is and show the angles the forces are making with x or y axis. Okay, draw all the forces and show the angles made by the forces with x and y axis. You don't need to show the angle if force is already along x and y axis. Fine. If it makes some angle, then you show the angle that it is 30 degrees, 40 degrees, whatever it is. Okay. That is step number 4. Step number 5, what do you think will be? Take components. Good. Take components of all the forces along x and y axis. Take components of all the forces along x and along y axis. Okay. That is step 5. Step number 6, what do you think it will be?
Add
all the forces along x axis and equate it to mass and acceleration along x axis. Write down. Add all the forces along x axis and equate that to mass and acceleration along x axis. That is step 6. And similarly for y axis. Under step 6 only you write. Written? So now you get two equations, one along x and one along y axis. Will you get only two equations in every question?
No, you can also have the z axis.
Suppose z axis is not there, only two equations?
X component, y component.
There can be more masses also. Two equations per mass. Are you getting it? So you have to do these steps for other masses also. Fine. You have to do these for the other masses also. Getting it? Then what? Then identify the constraints of the motion. Constraints of the motion. For constraint, there will be separate class of 4 hours just talking about constraint. Okay. So, we are skipping the constraint right now. We'll be talking about it later. Identify the constraints of the motion of the objects. Okay? Give me an example of constraints. Suppose one object is tied with the other object like this. Okay? If acceleration of this object this way is A, acceleration of that object is?
A
only, that is constraint. Okay, if you say this is A1, this is A2, number of equations will be less than number of variables. Okay, you have to identify them. This is a very simple constraint. There can be, you know, little tricky constraint also. For example, various pulleys are there, so many pulleys are there, and one mass is coming down. One mass acceleration is related to the other mass acceleration or not?
Yes,
sir. So what is the relation between them? That when you find, that is also constraint relation. Okay, when I am moving on a floor, I am constrained to move in forward direction only. I will not assume acceleration at some angle with the floor. Yes or no?
Yes.
So that automatically you are visualizing the problem and identifying the constraint without even, I mean, realizing that you are using constraint equation. Okay, and similarly a mass is kept on an incline, it slides down the incline like that, so acceleration is parallel to the inclined plane, it will not fly off, that is again a constraint. So like that there can be several constraints, you have to identify them. Okay, if you have already used the constraint, no problem. If you have not used it, identify one by one and write down equation related to it. For example, if you assume A1 and A2 here, the constraint equation relation will be A1 is equal to A2. Simple. Okay? There is nothing, there is no physics about it. It is mathematical. Okay? And at times, the most tricky part of a question is identifying constraint relation only. Everything else is straightforward. Identifying constraint equation is where the people struggle. Okay? Just to give you an example, I am not asking you to solve it, I am just giving you an example. Like this. Suppose this wedge can move on the surface. There is this rod which comes out from the two supports. Okay. then this rod can move down. And as this rod moves down, this wedge will move forward.
Yeah.
There's a relation between this acceleration and that acceleration. Yes or no?
Yeah.
You can write down the equation of motion by assuming this as A1 and this as A2, but number of equations will be less than the variable. So you have to get a relation between A1 and A2 also. Okay, another example, let me tell you, is this. Acceleration of this and acceleration of these two, they are related. This pulley can move up and down. Okay, so there is a relation among these three acceleration. Okay, another example could be like this. You know, this wedge can move. Guys, focus here. This wedge can move. Okay, so what will happen to this mass? This mass not only moves along the string, as the wedge moves, this moves with the wedge also. So there's a relation among this acceleration and that acceleration also. Okay, so only one thing in this laws of motion which we cannot put in some sequence, or I can't tell you a systematic way of identifying the constraint relation. It's more like a solving puzzle. Getting it? There are systematic methods to identify the constraint relation, but many a times it is your own visualization, and it's, I mean, whether you get the trick at that moment or not. Okay, so this is the most tricky part of the problem that we'll be not taking it right now, because this has nothing to do with vectors. Okay, so we'll be taking up simple question where you don't have to break your head on identifying the constraint relation, but they do exist. That's why there's this step of identifying the constraint relation. Alright, then step number 9 is solve these equations and get the answer. Alright guys, so we are all set finally to take up few numericals. Fine, tell me this one. There is this mass M. Okay. This surface is rough. Coefficient of friction is mu. Okay. There is this force F applied on it. F. You have to find out the acceleration of mass M. Follow all those steps one by one, sequentially. You may be slow when you're learning, but if you learn it systematically, your speed goes up. Okay, so one by one, all the steps you follow to solve this. Have you drawn the free body diagram?
Yeah.
I want to see free body diagram. I'm not interested in final answer, which might be wrong also. There's only one mass, so nothing there to shortlist,
right?
One of mass is this, and then what are the forces? Mg? Mg is down? Any doubt in that? Mg is down? Then what else? F is there, which is the external force. Then normal, how much? How it will be applied? Like this. Then, what else?
And then friction.
Friction.
Friction?
Yeah.
How much?
Mu n.
Why?
Because
this
roughness is.
Huh? Why mu n?
Mu is equal.
Mu is equal to friction.
But we are assuming it's moving then.
You're assuming it is moving. You're assuming it is moving. Suppose it is not moving. Then acceleration will be 0 and friction will be
F.
F. That case you have ignored. Okay. Acceleration will be 0. The maximum value of friction is how much?
Mu
times normal reaction. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's see here. I'll be taking one axis like this, x-axis, and this is along y-axis. Okay, net force along x-axis is what?
F minus friction.
F minus friction. Okay, this is net force. This will be equal to mass time acceleration
along
x-axis. X-axis. There is only one acceleration due to constraint. It will move only along x. Along y-axis, you have n minus mg. Is it, how many have written n is equal to mg directly? Don't do that. Okay, you may be doing well in this question. Okay, you will confuse yourself later on. All the forces left hand side. All the forces left hand side is equal to mass and acceleration on the right hand side. Keep it simple. Okay, okay. Leave your thought process for imagination. Don't assume the formula. Formula is what? Net force equal to mass and acceleration. Formula is not force on the left hand side is equal to force on the right hand side, which you have written. Fine. Although that may be mathematically equal, but physically it means nothing. Okay. Alright, so normal reaction is mg. From this equation, normal reaction is mg. So friction, maximum friction value will be equal to mu times m into g. Getting it? Fine. So, what is the maximum force for which A is 0? How will you find that? Put A equal to 0 here. F will be equal to Fr. So, F is, since F will be equal to Fr, because F minus Fr is 0, so F will be equal to Fr. So, maximum value of F is maximum value of friction, which is equal to mu m into g, right? So if you are applying any force less than mu mg, it will not move. Understood? All of you understood this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you are applying more force than mu mg, then what is the acceleration?
F minus mu mg divided by
m.
If force is more than mu mg, then it is accelerating forward. Okay, so then F minus mu times normal reaction, which is again mg only, will be equal to m into A. So A will be equal to F by m minus mu g. Fine? Any doubts? First question of laws of motion. Understood?
Yes.
Any doubts, please ask. Next question. Be careful. So, the first thing we have learned from this question is that you are ignoring cases. Okay? Acceleration may be zero. Alright? This question. Follow all these steps and get the value of acceleration for capital M. It's not as easy as it looks. That's the hint. Have you drawn free body diagram?
Yeah.
What are the forces?
Downward chain.
This is mg?
Yes.
Then?
Normal reaction.
Normal reaction.
There
is this force. What else?
Friction.
This is theta. How will you take your x and y axis?
U.
Normal one?
Yeah, normal.
Okay. The usual one. This is your free body diagram. Okay? Now what? You have to take component of all the forces along x and y axis. All the forces are already aligned except capital F. So you have to take component. So this component will be
F cos theta.
Correct. So this is F cos theta.
F sin.
And this is F sin.
Then
N doesn't matter.
What next? What next?
You can combine these two.
So equations along x-axis.
What is the equation along x-axis?
F cos theta minus fr.
F minus fr.
Is equal to max.
And
F sin theta plus M
minus M is equal to
MAY.
Is equal to
MAY.
MAY.
Will there be MAY? There will be AY?
Yeah.
There can be possibility.
Yeah.
So that's,
but
that's
if there is AY, friction will be?
Zero.
Normal reaction will be?
Zero.
If it moves up, friction will be zero, normal reaction will be zero. It loses the contact. Okay? So you have to consider cases and then solve it. Can you do it yourself now? It may happen that it doesn't move at all.
Yes.
That is another case. Case 1. Acceleration along x-axis, 0. Okay? Just here. If ax is 0, then what will be f cos theta minus fr?
F cos theta is
0. Yeah. Right? This is the case. If ax is 0, can ay be 0 necessarily?
No.
Need not
be 0.
If ay is there, what will be friction?
0.
So f cos theta will be the net force. It will create acceleration in x direction also.
Can you explain?
If AY is not 0, it is accelerating upwards.
Yeah.
Friction is gone. So can F cos theta be 0?
No. F cos theta.
So there will be an acceleration in X direction also.
Yeah.
Understood?
If AX is 0, then you can't have AY. If, yes, no,
yeah.
if AX is 0.
If AX is 0, you can't have AY also. Understood what I'm saying? If it lifts up, if it lifts up, there is nothing which opposes f cos theta. So there will be ax. F cos theta will be equal to m into ax.
So, but if ay is 0, then ax can also not be 0.
Yeah, that is
not.
That is correct. But case number 1, if ax is 0, ay is automatically 0.
Yeah. This is the hardest. We started the hardest.
Understood? All of you understood this? Okay. What is the maximum value of force for which AX is 0? Friction divided by cos theta. FR max. What is FR max? Mu times normal reaction. Okay. And along the vertical direction I can write N. Stop talking. N plus F sin theta minus Mg is equal to 0, right? So normal reaction will be equal to Mg minus F sin theta. Okay? So maximum value of friction is mu times of that. Fine. So F will become equal to mu times mg minus F sine theta divided by cos theta. Alright, so you can solve this equation to get the value of F. F is there on the right hand side also. So you can rearrange the term to get the value of F. Fine. So F will come out to be equal to mu mg divided by sine theta plus cos theta. This is the max force. Sine theta, no, mu sine theta. Mu sine theta plus cos theta. Understood? But you didn't get how. Can you do it yourself? You get it. Nothing but just simple cross multiplication.
No, the first part. So is this along the x-axis?
This one?
Y-axis.
This is along y-axis. This is along y.
The maximum.
No. For ax to be 0, ay also has to be 0. That is why net force along y-axis is 0. Understood? Next case is case number 2. Ax is not equal to 0, but ay is 0. And then third case is both are not equal to 0. Sorry. Both are not equal to 0. Fine? Can you do it for case number 2 and then for case number 3?
So case number 2 is ax and ay are both positive.
Case number 2, write down. Ax is not equal to 0, but Ay is 0. Solve this. It is accelerating forward, but not accelerating in y direction. Any doubts here? You have any doubts? Any doubts here?
So how do you go to the last step over there? FF.
Hey, yeah, you can do it yourself. You can get solve for F. Forget about this. Can you solve for F?
Yeah.
Do it now. Solve it. Forget about this. Can you solve for F? You will get this. If ax is 0, that means friction must be present. But if it moves up, who will create friction? It loses contact. Usually students will solve only for this case, case number 2. They forget other two cases. Okay, if ax is not equal to 0, then what should I write? F cos theta minus mu time. Since ax is not equal to 0, friction will be maximum possible. Mu times n, it is constant. This should be equal to m into a. Is this correct?
Yeah.
This is correct, right? Getting it? And vertically, what can I write? N plus F cos theta minus mg is equal to 0.
Sine theta.
You don't need to solve this. Just leave it till here. Solving this, you can get the value of A. Get N from here, substitute there, you get the value of A. Okay? Case number 2, both are not equal to 0. Case number 3, sorry. Case 3.
So you got a really weird answer.
This one?
No. 3, sir. It's like a big.
Well, big thing under the roof.
Yeah.
Huge thing.
Case number 3. Focus here. Ax not equal to 0 and Ay also not equal to 0. What will be the free body diagram for case number 3? What all things will be 0?
Friction
will be there or not?
Zero.
Friction will not be there. It is moving up.
And even
no
normal
contact.
Force is equal.
Even normal force is gone.
Yes, sir.
Only this much is the free body diagram. If it moves up. Getting it? Any doubt? But you can divide the equation into two components. This is AY and this is AX. Net force along, net force horizontally is what now? F cos theta only? So F cos theta will be equal to M into AX and vertically what?
F sin theta minus
mg is equal to m a y. These are two equations. That's it. Total acceleration will be root over ax square plus ay square. Ax and ay are the component of acceleration along x and y. Any doubts? So we have learned many things from just one simple question. People ignore case number 1 and case number 3. They just focus on case 2. Now, please relook it at again and let me know if you have any doubts. Read it again. It is important that you understand this. If you have not understood, have any doubts, please ask.
What? AX is F cos by M. AY is F sin theta minus M by M. Solve it. Like that. There is no x, no other variable. Ax is equal to x plus y, right? Ay is x sin theta minus mg by y.
See, I can understand this is the beginning of this thing, second law of motion chapter or laws of motion chapter. So, to start with, there will be a lot of hesitation, or you will feel that very difficult questions are, these are difficult questions. But all it takes, just 10-15 such questions and then you'll be at ease with it. Okay? I can show you very, very simple question. You just directly substitute force and acceleration, you'll get it, answer. But the reality is, straightforward questions are not asked. Okay? So, let's not do something which is not asked. Okay, what is the point of, you know, I telling you 5 Newton force is this way and mass is 5 kg, so what is the acceleration? You'll find, oh, acceleration is 1 Newton per second square. You feel happy about yourself that, yes, I understood. That doesn't mean anything. Getting it? So we have to go through with the phase of frustration and with the phase of, you know, solving a lot of difficult questions. Then only it will help you do something. Okay? Root over ax square plus ay square. Acceleration is ax I cap plus ay j cap. Okay. Ax is f cos theta by m. Ay is f sin theta minus mg by m. Okay. So now I am going to introduce something which will come again and again in questions. Okay, that is inclined plane. Okay,
this is everything.
Suppose this is angle theta. Okay, you have a mass kept on it. Mass is capital M. Coefficient of friction is mu. You have to find acceleration of capital M.
No force applied.
No force applied.
Gravity.
Gravity will be there. I don't need to specify gravity is there. Show all the forces. Only forces. Done? Normal force will not be like that. Normal force will push it up. Friction will act opposite the direction of its motion. So case number 1, acceleration is not equal to 0. drawn three ball diagram. Take the mass like this as it is.
Downward is mg.
Then upward as in vertical. This is normal reaction. What else? Friction is like this or like that? Opposite to the direction of motion. This way. How much will be the friction? Mu times n. Because it is sliding. This is capital M. Okay? Now what is, which direction take x and y axis?
Along
the incline. Right? Because even acceleration is like this. So it makes sense to take x and y axis like that. This is y and that is x. Getting it? Now what? You have three vectors aligned in either x and y axis. Mg is not. Take component of mg. What it will be?
Mg cos theta will be down one and mg sin theta.
Minus mg.
What is this angle?
Which angle?
This angle.
45?
No, wait. 90 minus theta.
This is 90 minus theta. This is theta. This was mg. This was mg. So this one will be mg cos theta. Okay? So this direction of this direction, the component of mg is mg cos theta. Mg sin theta. Getting it? Any doubts? Any doubts here? Now all the vectors including acceleration are aligned either in x or y direction. So I can write down force equal to mass time acceleration along x and y.
Yeah.
Quickly tell me what it is. Acceleration is what?
Acceleration along the x axis will be mg sin theta minus mu n will be mx.
Net force along y axis is what? N minus
mg cos theta.
Mg cos theta. This will be equal to?
Zero.
Yeah. So normal reaction will be equal to? Mg cos theta. Along x axis. Guys, one more thing. When we write force equal to mass and acceleration, direction of acceleration we usually take positive. Direction of acceleration is positive. So all the forces acting in the direction of acceleration is positive. Opposite, it will be negative. So
friction is negative.
So is it log x is g sin theta minus mg?
So mg sin theta minus friction, which is how much? Mu times?
Mg cos
theta. Mu times n.
Mu times mg cos theta.
Mu times n.
Okay.
Mu n. This is the net force is equal to mass time acceleration.
So we can't write n and mg cos theta.
We'll write it now. Why there is a hurry? If you hurry up, you'll only understand this question. But whatever you learned here, you have to use it in other questions also. Okay? I understand what is... you think that is redundant to write like this? I have been writing it 100 times at least. Same thing.
So why is acceleration along the y-axis zero?
So it's not going up.
It is not moving perpendicular to the plane. It cannot. On its own.
Yeah.
That's a constraint. That's a constraint. Okay? Getting it? Any doubts? Here? Okay, so when you solve this, you'll get the value of acceleration. Fine?